Okay, so my name is Leticia. I am 36 years old. I live in San Diego. I've been living in San Diego since I was 6 years old. So about 26 years living here in the U.S. I have a child. I have one child, and he's a boy. He's 11 years old, and I live here with my mother and my sister. I was detained at the Otay Detention Center last year, from January to July. These people came here to my house making up stories, because that's what they do now. They make up stories and say that you have committed the crime when you never have. They come to your house, they invade your house, they take you away from your family, from your children, you get separated from them, and then they take you to jail. When I got there, it was mostly Latino women, women from Mexico, from El Salvador, and then women from Africa. There was a whole bunch of them, and a lot of them, we had two microwaves for everyone. So during lunchtime, it was just absolutely craziness, because imagine 100 people trying to use, you know, two microwaves. I was blessed to get along with everyone because I spoke English, so I was always helping everyone with something, you know? Mm-hmm. Everyone always needed help for something or for translating or whatever. Mm-hmm. So I got along with everyone. It was a two-floor place. There was about maybe 18 rooms, and in each room there was 8 beds, so there was 8 people in each room. We had a little yard outside, which was enclosed. So the only thing that we were able to see was like the sky, pretty much. It's a whole setup, and it's very sad. Till this day, I have a hard time even talking about it. I was there for 6 months, and it was the worst 6 months I've ever lived in my whole life. All the things that happened there, and I'm just scared that I'm gonna be taken away from my family, from my son. And this is what people don't understand. We come into panic. Now we don't know what to expect, what's gonna happen, and we're gonna be taken away. And I'm taking medication, you know, for my therapist. And it's really hard to have a normal life now.
It's clean.
Mm-hmm. And these are the things that people don't know, you know. They're hurting us, you know. These are scars that are never going to go away. These are the things that is gonna haunt us forever. And not just us, but our kids, our family as well. Yeah, so everyone that was in there, in this unit, it was a violation of immigration. Nobody in there were criminals. Nobody in there has had nothing bad to do. We were just immigrants. That's the reason why we were detained and being held in this jail, because it's not a detention center, it's jail. That's what it is. They, as much as they want to sugarcoat this, mm-hmm. it's jail, you know? And a lot of these women, they were there for a year, 2 years. And I thought to myself, oh my God, like, how long am I gonna be here? I can't do it. And I was just not trying to lose hope and faith. Because I was like, I cannot be here for this long, taking this treatment, eating this food. The AC is super cold. Like, my body was hurting every day because it was so cold in there, you know? And then taking showers with this, like, steaming hot water, it was just, I couldn't take it anymore. I was trying to stay positive. We had, like, a little, like, church group in there, you know? And we were praying every day, and it was just, I felt like
I was going crazy there. And I was like, I don't know how I'm gonna be once I get out. I don't think I'm ever gonna be normal. And so that's one of the things I fight every day. Like, when I'm sleeping, I wake up and I'm like, please God, don't let me be in there. I don't want to be away from my family. And it's so hard. That's why I can't sleep. That's why I can't eat. I can't function the way I used to function before. You know, I'm just constantly scared what's gonna happen, and it's so hard.
Around March, they brought a whole bunch of Chinese women into our unit. And a few of them had masks on, which none of us inside the unit, out of 100 women, none of us had masks, but these Chinese women did have masks on. And we thought it was, you know, we thought it was kind of weird that they would bring them into our unit and then wearing masks. And so one of those Chinese girls was getting really sick. She was showing symptoms, like she had really high fever. It looked like her body was like deteriorating, like she wasn't walking the same anymore. And they took her away from the unit, and we didn't hear from her in days. So we didn't know what happened to her, and we thought, you know what, maybe she has COVID. And the officers didn't, we kept asking, and the officers didn't want to tell us anything. So that was the first girl that had COVID, and we thought, we got scared because we were like, that girl was between all of us. You know, there's 8 girls in that room, but then those 8 girls come around everyone else. And we thought, oh my gosh, like, what if we have COVID and we don't know? And other girls started showing symptoms as well. And in my room, there was 4 girls that had COVID, in my room. And it was just, it was scary being around them, you know? Because after even quarantine, after they came back, like I said, some of the girls, they were still sick. They were still showing symptoms. They still had fever. And I was telling my mother, like, I'm scared. I don't know what to do. These women, we all sleep in the same room. We all, you know, use the same sink. We all use the same microwave. Like, we use everything, you know. We don't have any gloves. And I was like, and I was, after I had spoken to her, I was feeling very sick at nighttime. And I told her, like, I had a fever and I had woken up with blisters on my body. And I was just like, Mom, I'm scared. Like, I don't know if I'm gonna catch COVID and die in here. Like, I'm never gonna be able to see you, my son. What am I gonna tell my son? And my son knew about COVID, and he was like, Mom, like, you know, I watched the news, you know, like, you don't have to lie to me anymore. Like, I heard that there's, you know, some women that have the COVID in your unit, you know, and please tell me the truth. And I was like, I don't know what to say to my son, to my mother. And us trying to call organizations and trying to, you know, get help, and it was just, it seemed like it was, we were just helpless, all of us in there. And I thought, I'm never gonna be able to leave this place. It would be just me, like, in a bag, you know, leaving this place. And I was like, maybe that's the only way I'm gonna be free. In a bag. We heard like the whole commotion like going on outside, because at that time we had our yard time, so we were outside and we heard a lot of people like honking, you know, and like yelling and stuff. And we were like, we didn't know what was going on because we can't see. And My mother told me, she was like, oh no, there's people protesting outside because I had spoken to her on the phone. The detainees were really happy because they thought, oh my gosh, they're fighting for our rights. They're trying to do something for us, you know? Mm-hmm. And for us, it was a really good feeling knowing that there was people outside trying to help us and try to support us. It made us not want to stop writing letters outside trying to get help, or it made us not like give up, you know? Because a lot of the people in there, they wanted to commit suicide, you know? It made us continue making those calls, reaching out to organizations that were helping us. And it was very inspiring just knowing that people cared about us immigrants. And it made us stronger and not want to give up and just fight for our rights, fight for our family, fight to stay here. But I just want to say that, like, you guys are just amazing for trying to help us, because it's really hard for all those people that are in there. Life is already tough in there, and just that little hope that you guys give us means the world to us. And it's really, really appreciated, because everyone in there needs some type of support, you know? Mm-hmm.